Yesterday I left Perth after being there for about 4 weeks, minus the week that I went back home. Really a nice stay over there. It was super hectic. Every day was full of meetings and nice things. And yeah, I could nice stay with my own family, which was also super convenient. And then yesterday I went to Mandurah, which is just about 70k or something from Perth. And I'm here with Jenny de Kahn. Jenny and I, we go way back, like literally. Where did we meet?
Adelaide.
Adelaide, and that was 9 years ago, eh?
Yep.
Or 10 years maybe?
Yeah.
When I was backpacking there and you were backpacking there. How did you, and you stayed here? Or did you go back after that trip? Or what did you do?
After the Adelaide trip?
Yeah.
I kept traveling.
You kept traveling, yeah?
Yeah.
So you haven't been back home since?
I have been back home for 6 months.
Yeah.
Couldn't leave Australia.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, amazing. So then, yeah, you now, and you have a really nice home. You have 2 kids now and a husband. Amazing, yes. Huh?
And it is amazing.
And I don't know where I will sleep tomorrow even. And you have a life, a stable life over here.
Yeah.
Yeah, super cool. I am on my way to Margaret River today, which is just over 200 km from Mandurah. A lot of wind, so today I couldn't make it, but that was not a really big problem because along the south of Western Australia you'll find the RAC Electric Highway. And yeah, they built like everywhere these fast charging stations, which is really convenient. And previously it was not for me not possible to charge my car here because they have the charging cable attached to the station and then I cannot plug it into my car. But some guys here from the Australian Electric Vehicle Association, he said, yeah, you can cut off 11 millimeters for your cable, your own cable, put it into the cable which is attached to the station, and then you can plug it into your car. And that works. So now I'm charging. It costs money also, this is not free. But I met in Perth, I met Patrick from E-Station, who gave me this net charge car. Yeah, he said, yeah, you can use this car in case you need to pay for their charging. So thanks a lot, Patrick and E-Station.
There's an old John Deere underneath the tree, 500 acres, my dad and me worked this land until we hurt, trying to make a living out of plain old dirt.
I just arrived here close to Margaret River in the Toby home. It's a house, a tiny home built in a container, I think that it is. And I'm here with the owner, Simon. Simon, thanks for inviting me here.
Hello, but you're most welcome, mate. You're most welcome.
Yeah,
it's a pleasure to have you.
Yeah, great. Yeah, please tell me about this. I'm amazed by how it looks and how much space you got into kind of a small space.
Excellent. Look, I've always been a bit of a fan of tiny homes and minimalism.
Yeah.
I'm a sheet metal worker by trade and also love building, so this kind of developed from that passion. Plus I had, with my trade, I've got a balustrade business, and we had some windows and odd pieces of glass left over that I felt would go to some good use. It's all started with this piece here, in actual fact. This nice big piece of double glazed that just happened to be a perfect fit for that picture window overlooking the inlet here. So it was started probably about 2 years ago, and it was in sort of an infill job for the guys at work when we through the quieter months of winter, and yeah, it just kind of developed, and what was initially going to be something quite simple got a little bit carried away and wanted to make it quite architectural, and this is the end product. Yeah,
yeah.
So we've used lots of double glazing. Lots of high set windows for plenty of airflow.
Yeah.
Lots of insulation, as you can probably tell when you're in there. It's very quiet when you close all the doors, very silent.
Yeah.
And perfectly north facing, so that's direct north. I'm very fortunate here with that outlook, plus the north facing, get the winter sun going through the whole place. Beautiful views down the inlet.
Good morning. I just woke up here in this amazing place, and yeah, when I opened my door this morning, there were swans floating around here. It's stunning. And this makes me just think, like, why should I ever stop this trip, you know? It's everything that comes on my path, it's so amazing.
Fortunately, I need to check out really early. It's also nice because I have some interesting meetings in Margaret River, just about 34 km from here. This weekend it's Sustainable Housing Day. That's actually the reason I came to Margaret River. Tomorrow we'll be visiting a lot of houses, mainly tiny houses, which have been built in a very sustainable way. So this morning I arrived in Margaret River, and last night my car didn't completely charge, so I went to one of these fancy charging stations, just was like yesterday. And then I was waiting there, and then this guy just stopped his car and said, "Hey, I offered you a place to stay like yesterday."
There you go.
Hi, how are you?
Good, I'm Jamie.
Jamie, yeah, how did you find out about me?
Through a guy I work for who's an electric car expert.
Yeah, yeah.
And he basically said you were coming, and I looked you up on the website, and couldn't not help.
Yeah,
yeah. What you're doing. So.
Yeah, too funny. And that guy is Rod, and I'll be staying here with him tonight also. That was already arranged, so it's
coincidence. So you're staying with Rod Dilks. Yeah.
Rod Dilks, yeah.
He does electric, you know, he does lithium batteries really. And
okay,
that kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And yeah, you drive also an electric car. And
yeah, so this is my car that, with Rod's guidance, I've converted this. And that's it there.
Wow.
So it's a Proton Jumbuck.
Yeah. It's a Malaysian car, right? It's Proton.
Malaysian car, yep. So that's a three phase motor controller. And yeah.
Batteries?
Batteries in the back. Let's have a
look. Yeah. All right. Wow, it's a ute. I think this is the first time I've seen an electric ute. That's for Australia, obviously, pretty convenient.
Pretty handy, yeah.
Yeah. Do you cover long distances with it?
About 150 km.
150 km,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So under there is all the batteries.
Right.
So there's 28 units of batteries in there. You've got 37 in your car.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's basically 90 of these.
Okay.
And they're pretty light. They're about 300 kilos of batteries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Jamie then let me drive his electric car, and together we visited a cave.
Good morning. I skipped a day with filming. Yesterday I was supposed to do a lot of nice stuff on Sustainable House Day. I was supposed to visit a lot of houses and give some talks, but I got sick. Luckily there was the organizers, they were very nice, and they offered me a place to stay in this beautiful studio. I slept right on top of there, and yeah, it's so cute here, I think. It's beautiful. But today I'm going to leave Margaret River and do something really fun.
Currently, I'm traveling through Australia's southwest region. Breathtaking coastal and forest scenery, and well known for its endless vineyards. It is very diverse. During the annual migration, you can watch humpback whales, and inland you can find hidden gems in ancient caves. And the area has unique flora and fauna. My next stop is Greenbushes. Rob from the Tesla Owners Club has set up a meeting with Tellison. As an electric car driver, I am very interested to learn how my battery is produced, and I have been told that this is even the world's biggest lithium mine. Is that correct?
That's right. So we supply a third of the world's lithium. So the lithium we mine is a spodumene mineral, and so we mine that here, we concentrate it, upgrade it, and then we send it to the lithium converters. So they convert the lithium or the spodumene mineral into lithium hydroxide or lithium carbonate. So most of that conversion happens in China at the moment by our two owners, Albemarle and Tianqi. And they convert that into hydroxide or carbonate, and that in turn is then used in the components for the anodes and the cathodes to make the actual battery. There's a little bit of history with the mine here. They've been mining here for well over 135 years. But not initially mining lithium, of course. Lithium's a new mineral, new industrial mineral. So initially it was alluvial tin mining, and that happened in all the alluvial deposits, and then eventually they mined the hard rock tin, and then eventually we started mining tantalum in the middle of last century. And tantalum's used to make high quality capacitors, high efficient capacitors and small capacitors, so used in the electronics industry, but also alloys in the technology like jet engines and gas turbines and those type of things, and aeroplanes and those type of things. So a lot of history with the mining, and eventually we started exploring the area and we found that there were high zones of tantalum and high zones of lithium. And then they started looking, well, how can they exploit the lithium? And eventually they started the lithium minerals industry here. So the previous industry was all lithium brines, so made from like the salt lakes and the Atacama Desert and other places of the world. But they started mining lithium minerals here to go into the fine china. So it's got some very unique properties. It's got a very low coefficient of expansion, so it doesn't crack when it expands and contracts under temperature. So in the old days, when maybe your grandmother used to take a Pyrex bowl out of the fridge, she didn't throw it straight in the oven, otherwise it used to crack. She used to leave it on the counter, wait till it got to room temperature, and then put it in the oven, and vice versa. So that was the original applications. And then also lead was used in to make lead crystal, but of course environmentally it's not that friendly, so they started using lithium in place of the lead in the lead crystals. So perfume bottles, laboratory ware, and all those type of things. One of the more recent applications is in induction cooktops. So lots of people have got those throughout the world, and that's what's used to make that glass, is the lithium inside there that stops it from cracking when it expands or contracts. And of course on your phone, you've got Gorilla Glass, as we call it, that high temperature and high shock resistant glass. That's got lithium in it as well, besides the lithium that's used to make the battery inside your phone. So the original demand went from that to the little phone batteries, and then eventually to all the tools, so all the drills and those type of hand tools. That's where the big demand increased, and then of course the lithium car industry as well. And then subsequent to that, we've got to the grid stabilization batteries, where a large volumes of lithium is used to make those battery packs. But on a day-to-day basis, as I said, we make a third of the world's lithium. It comes from Greenbushes. And we would have at least 90 people here on site every day, going right from the mining side, which is in our background here, mining the lithium. So we drill and blast it, haul it to a crusher, where we crush it down to a size so we can then put it through a process plant. And then we use various metallurgical recoveries to recover the lithium and reject some of the waste. And we upgrade it from around about the 2-2.5% up to 6% Li2O. And might not sound very high, but 100% spodumene is 8% anyway. So 6% is quite high. And then of course that is then shipped out of Bunbury in bulk ships to China, where it's converted.
Kate, who is the technical superintendent, took me to the chemical grade plant where they produce a lithium concentrate for the two owners, Chunky and Albemarle, who processes further into lithium hydroxide, which is ultimately used to manufacture lithium batteries for electric vehicles and other products. Run of mine ore is crushed and then ground down using ball mills to a size where the valuable minerals can be liberated from the non-valuable minerals. This material is transported to subsequent areas of the plant as a slurry. The slurry is classified into different size fractions with vibrating screens and classifiers, where separation of the valuable and non-valuable materials can then be achieved through heavy media separation or flotation. The products from this separation and upgrade are then filtered to remove the water and transported by conveyor to the final ore stockpile for storage, until transported via truck to the Bunbury port for export. Lithium has been used for many years in different products, but I was curious if the recent uptake of electric vehicles had an impact on the mine.
The increase in demand, and I think the demand's all driven by the regulations that have been set across EU and a lot of the other countries like the States and China, where they said by a certain date a certain percentage of their vehicles need to be hybrid or electric vehicles. And of course that's driven the demand for the increase in electric cars. But on top of that, as soon as you get to a critical mass, people can afford a vehicle, more people will buy it, and therefore the economics bring it into demand, and yeah. it becomes more affordable, more demand, and therefore we've had to increase our production.
Yeah.
So we've increased our production from now about 600,000 tons a year, which includes technical grade as well as chemical grade, and we're expanding that to 1.2 million tons. And like the process plant we saw today, we're going to double that again. We'll go to about 2.3 million tons within about 4 years.
Wow, amazing. And do you need to dig new holes for that or something? Are you going to keep up with that?
So most of the ore body is what's behind us here, so we'll just mine that quicker. It's open-ended at depth, so the pit's going to get quite large. It'll be 2.6 k's long and 1 to 1.6 k's wide. So it'll be significant, up to 400 or 500 meters deep. But after that, we'll probably go underground, bulk underground mining. But to maintain our 20-year life, which is what we've got at the moment, we are doing some exploration around here and looking at some of the historic pegmatites we've identified. But because of the current economics, some of those are now viable to mine. So we are exploring to maintain our 20-year reserves.
That's it for this episode. In the next one, I'm going to hunt for raw opals and exploring more of this beautiful region. If you have enjoyed this, please subscribe to this channel.